Welcome to the Female Tech Heroes Conference, the three of you. So we're going to talk about networking. Before we start, I am curious because Hilde just shared an experience. I have that too. Sometimes it does feel awkward. Who has that too? Sometimes, yeah. Okay, a little bit awkwardness. And that's okay, because we're all human, right? So we're going to talk about that, because networking is also, it has a lot of power. And we're going to talk about that and possibilities. So in our lives, we're looking for meaningful connections as well as in our professional lives. So one of our crew members from Female Tech Heroes, Cheryl Boyd, where are you? So she wrote to me about networking, and I really like it, so I'm going to quote you. She said, "We're actually always networking, right? If it's here at the Female Tech Heroes Conference, if it's at the supermarket or the bus stop. So the question is, who will you meet today that could have a profound effect on your life?" It's an interesting question to talk about. So give a big applause again to our three panelists, please. Simone Brummelhuis, Fund Director and Partner at Borski Fund, Guus, Frericks, Founder and Managing Partner at DeepTechXL, and since Astrid Balsink of Philips could not make it, we have an extra applause for our extra panelist, Beata Wandachowicz. Give her a big applause, please. Thank you. Who stepped in one day before the conference, and she is Director of Third Party Risk and Compliance at Organon. Welcome. So Beata, what does networking mean to you, the power of networking?
Well, we have to start from what networking actually means. For me, since a couple of years ago already, I really discovered that you can't really do it on your own, as Angela, you said, and actually networking is the new currency. It's really powerful. Money is powerful, networking is even more powerful. So that's basically, if you talk about power of networking, it's definitely there. It's just a matter of how to make use of it. Like, are you aware what your network is, how you want to build it, how you want to make use of that for you and mostly for others. So for me, I had to learn also about that. And I agree, it's not always comfortable, but yeah, it's really magical if you see how it, what it can do, and I can share some examples with you as well.
Great, I'm going to come back on that as well. Guus, could you give us an example of what the power of networking could be?
Yeah, I think if you are able to mobilize a relevant network, you can realize your dreams, and that means that it's up to you what's your dream. In my case, I wanted to build a startup factory in Eindhoven, and there was an idea, and I mobilized the network to make it happen. And then I wanted to create an investment fund for deep tech, 100 million. And people said, start small, 20 is enough. I said, no, 100, and otherwise we don't even start.
And we mobilized. And he did it, right? 100 million euros, so he did it, yeah. But yeah, it sounds really easy, just use your network, but how?
Well, personally, I believe that, you know, in today's business, everything gets integrated. It used to be, you know, vertical companies doing everything, including the supply chain. Yeah, that whole world has changed, and it's organizations are the boundaries are getting more vague. There's more intense collaboration throughout vertical industries, and that's the nature of today's business, and yeah, that's then you need to manage the network.
Is it easier to connect to people?
Well, it depends. I'm also now, the previous speaker said, yeah, I'm not so, or no, Hilde said it, I'm not so always, you know, talkative on things. I'm like that as well. If you put me in a big group, I'd rather be silent. But for my job, to get stuff done, I need to climb on stage and I need to get out of my comfort zone and make it happen. And have the guts, for instance, in my case, when I started with the idea, one of the first things I did was I used to work for Frans van Houten at Philips Semiconductors. So I was like, yeah, my idea of the startup factory is only going to work if it stands on the shoulders of the big giants in the region. So I wrote him an email. I hadn't spoken to him for like 4 or 5 years, but I wrote him an email and I said, hey, Frans, I'm going to build this startup factory in Eindhoven, and these are the 10 reasons why I believe Philips must be part of it. Yeah, that's a bold move. Is he going to react? He has tons of things on his plate. He responded the same day. He said, yeah, meet with Hans de Jong. He's the CEO of Philips Netherlands. It's his mandate. And then you need to go to Hans de Jong. I didn't know Hans de Jong. So yeah, you go there and then Frans often says something which needs to happen, but it doesn't mean anything. I'm the guy here. I hope he's not in the audience. you can take it, it's an honest answer. But then, yeah, you develop a relationship with Hans de Jong, but the first time I met him, I was like, oh, he's really cool and distant. And so it took me a couple of meetings to loose him up a little bit.
But it sometimes it can feel the distance where you talk about. I mean, if you admire someone, for example, you admire someone, a big VP from a tech company. Okay, you add them to LinkedIn and they accept you. You're like, okay, wow, nice. But then, I mean, you send them an email, and is it that easy?
No, you need to. In my view, you need to make an effort to develop the relationship. I mean. To make networking work, you need to give more than you take. And if you do that consistently, and you do that with the true intention to also help others, then eventually you get the return and it becomes easy.
And could you give an example of how you gave a lot?
A question to, because otherwise I'm talking. The startup factory, in the beginning, I invested all my money in it. I didn't ask for salary, I just invest, and I burnt all the money, and I ended up in trouble with the family situation. And I did that for 3 years, and people said, you're completely crazy. You are this VP from, I was VP and got the president, CEO, and these kind of functions in bigger corporations. But after 3 years, then people said, so there was blood, sweat, and tears. I worked every single day. I slept only a few hours. I was stressed. I was worried about how to pay the salaries. Yeah, and then in year four, you start to see return. People give back, and now it is an unstoppable train, if you ask me.
Fantastic. Simone, how do you look at this?
Networking.
Yeah. And the power of it. Mm-hmm. Do you see yourself as a natural networker?
Well, I do think that networking is, everybody has a network. And whether it's your family, which is your first network, and you can use that for your private life, and sometimes your family can assist you in your professional life. So that's one network that you have. Probably you have a network from school, university, your neighborhood, your first job. There are so many networks that if you really start to think about it, then I think that is that you are in a lot of circles, and with some people you have more connection, which is the network, and some networks are a bit further, and some connections in your network, you haven't maintained them, so then you can't ask or you can't give a lot, but I think when people start to think about network, that's how they need to start, to think about, who is actually in my network. So when people say, I don't have a network, then no one has no network. It might be small, but you do have and what happens then, if you put you just put it on a sheet, then you make these connections and you see all of a sudden then there's something in these networks that you, that can happen if you maintain them and if you put something into it or you take something out of it. And I think that's how I see it. And so, am I a natural networker? Yeah, maybe I am, but I also like to be on my own. So I also have to it's an effort also that you have to do to maintain your network. And sometimes I'm in networks where people maintain the networks and I'm not the one who's maintaining it. And then you can't be, if you're not that generous, then you also can't ask a lot of a network. So that's how I see networks.
Do you see differences in how people do it, the networking part?
Sometimes. So what happens sometimes in events like this, you stand, especially after you have a panel and then people come after you to to the network, and they entrepreneurs are sometimes a little bit different than corporates. Entrepreneurs are extroverts, most of them are want to talk about their product and their business, and actually a lot about their product, not so much about their business. So what sometimes happens in these events is that people come up to you and they start, you know, they're off. They just want pitching to you.
Their complete pitch.
Yeah, it's their complete pitch. And that is actually not necessary, because it's only, there are most of the time a couple of things that you remember, and these are the things that why you want to, you know, even open up your network, or you want to just know a bit more. So that is one thing. So you don't have to pitch the first time if you are meeting someone.
But what do you have to do?
Sometimes you can even be quiet, and that's also quite mysterious and good. Some people, it's true, because if you are in a group and someone is very quiet and there is someone in the audience or someone in that group who's really interested, that person will then say, okay, and who are you and what are you doing actually? So, you know, it doesn't you don't even have to be an extrovert to, you know, to be a very good networker. And especially in a, for example, how many people are here? 200?
300, yeah.
So don't even try to get increase your network by 300 today. If you have three valuable connections after today, it's probably worth it more than, you know, just go after. But it could very well be that you know someone in this audience you really want to talk to, but you don't know how to get to that person. And then there are always people here in the audience or wherever you are who want to support you in getting that connection. So that helps as well. So you have to be a bit strategic also about it, I think.
Beata, what are your experiences in this?
Many. So I think when I look at networking, it's really like you need to have your social net and learn how to make it work. And this is basically networking. That, you know, otherwise you just have connections that can be pretty dead because you don't cultivate them. It's about investing your time in maintaining your relationships. It's really about human connection, and it really takes time. And if you think, well, I can network from the comfort of my couch, it's not going to happen. So it's really like conscious decision, like, yeah, I need to be out there, I need to get to know people and start interacting with others, and then, yeah, in this way, yeah, you need to put yourself out there. So it's really important with networking about who knows about you, right? It's not so much like who do you know, because it's really about how your network can actually work for your on your behalf, and we open it up for you as well. So just to give you some examples, I can give you two examples maybe quickly. One, how to work, like in my experience, what happened outside of my company, and also how you can network internally. Because I think I young faces, so maybe you would like to like also learn how to do it in your own job. So one, I think about like 10 years ago, I got a chance to be part of Supply Chain Finance Consortium, which was part of a collaboration of universities, corporates, to basically work on research on supply chain finance models. Well, I was young, and it happened, and I got actually that opportunity when I was like half a year in that job. So I wasn't an expert at that time, but I got a chance, and I spoke with my manager, like, are you sure that I should go? Like, there are treasurers and bankers and professors, like from Nyenrode. And I was actually, maybe just to add, 1.5 years in the Netherlands then, because I'm also an expat. So it wasn't comfortable, but basically, you know, I love working with others. I used to work with universities when I was back in Poland. And I'm like, okay, let me use this opportunity. And when I met those people, it turned out like, you know, you are actually an expert because you talk about the experience and the results that I was basically working on at Fe+ on a daily basis back then. So actually, I was bringing my expertise to the table, something that other people didn't know because they were just starting the program that we actually were already, like, we already implemented. And, you know, so I was actually thinking, okay, what's the structure of that program and that connection? And it was like, yeah, we will have like maybe meetings once in 2 months, and then we will see, and then we can exchange the progress of different research. And I was like, okay, we can do that. But I'm like, what can I do to basically work on my relationship with those people? Like, can I do it more often? Can I invite interns? Can we do like, can we do it in a more exciting way and more engaging way? Yeah, and then I just got recognized by all of those people in that network that, yeah, this is what I bring to the table, and I'm really excited. And we had like new insights, new models developed. And then a year later, they invited me for a conference as a speaker, a year later to be a panelist, a year later to be a judge in Supply Chain Finance Award, where we had 30 companies and banks applying for award, which was like Nike and Puma, Lufthansa. So it was really like huge corporates. Yeah, and then I was there with age like 34, and I was a judge among all of the other big bankers. So you can really make it work, but it's reinvesting in the relationship and maintaining those relationships. So this is what network can do, because I did it. But it was really about, not about me, it was about what do I bring and how can I help them also, you know, build something new together. So that is how what happened outside. Internally, because I was actually, it's a nice link, I was very often in those networks and conferences the only woman in the room. So I love the diversity over here. It wasn't comfortable being on stage when I was the only woman. Networking, because we had like drinks afterwards. How do you do that? It feels uncomfortable. Like, how do I belong here even? Like, how can I be part of that group? And then I realized, that actually triggered my passion. Like, I want to make sure that also women get a chance to be there. Like, why don't they get the ticket to those events? Like, why? And then actually there was another thing, and I will be very quick. I realized at 1 year at that conference that, there were also like different stands of banks and fintech companies. And 1 year that guy was working and this, like standing and representing this fintech. And then the next year he was over there. And then the banker from here was working on like next year over there. And like, this is that magical platform where actually you build connections and you have your opportunities for growth. And there were literally zero women. So that basically triggered me a lot. Like, I want women to be empowered to actually have the same chances. And yeah, I started that internal movement for celebrating diversity and inclusion at Philips that we did for 5 years, and I actually took a lead to do it. So I prepared a big presentation with concept, as you had to sell your ideas as well. Like, why do we need to do it? And I'm like, yeah, EXCO has to actually support this. And I was not from HR, and I was just somewhere there in the organization. But also through the network, like, how can we land my proposal on the desk of our chief HR officer that he actually sees this? And this happened. So actually I spoke with my mentor. She knew somebody who was actually very closely working with him, and it landed on his desk. And the next day we got an approval. It was 2018 when we did the first event. Yes, you got my sponsorship, let's do it. And we had a beautiful event to change the culture, to re-celebrate inclusion and diversity.
And that's a beautiful example. And it's also about the power of using your network and giving back. And
yes.
Guus, if people are sitting here, you're thinking about it, how can you start? How do you create a diverse network around you? Where do you start? As Simone already said, think about the people around you, so we all have a network. But what if you want to grow your professional network? Do you have any advice on that?
Start with yourself. What's your dream? What is truly motivating you? Where do you want to go? And it doesn't need to be perfect, but it starts with a dream. Why? Because if you're truly intrinsically motivated on pursuing a certain direction, you radiate different energy. And if you have a sense of direction, it's easier then to start thinking. And it doesn't matter what is the scale of your dream. Eh? So you can dream really big, you can, as long as you dream and it is your dream. That sets a direction that triggers an intrinsic motivation, a passion. If you are truly serious and you are in love with what you are doing, people will recognize it. It's very easy to spot who people who are really passionate about what they are doing. They talk different, they engage different. It doesn't matter, introvert or extrovert, you just sense it in the energy. And then, yeah, you need to think carefully about, you know, what do I need in terms of surroundings and boundary conditions to realize my dream? Yeah, and then live your dream. And living a dream is 86,400 seconds a day. And yeah, and I'm saying this deliberately because so many people are frustrated about this, that, and so on in the history. You know, guess what? You can feel negative about it, but one thing is for sure, you can't reverse it. The only thing you can do is learn from it. And then there is another group who are overly concerned about, yeah, but tomorrow and next week and in a year and blah, blah, blah. But you know, if I step in my car, I could end up in an accident. I hope I don't, but it's now. It's now in this moment, and then it becomes really simple, you know, how can I make the 86,400 seconds work for me? And then it becomes manageable, because then you can think, I do that as a kind of mantra every morning. How, when is this day going to be good for my direct environment at work? Because I spend a lot of time. Then I think, what am I going to do? How am I going to allocate these scarce seconds on my friends? How am I going to be an okay dad today for my kids? How am I going to be a good husband? And then I just, you know, break up the day in chunks and I enjoy it. I woke up this morning and I was so excited to go to work because, you know, I had a team meeting with the team and we had 30 students coming and that was just before here, and yeah, I did everything I could within my power. When you came, you said, hey, we want to develop this community. I said, let's go. Every time you call me, I will be there. And I enjoy it. I truly enjoy it. But if you ask me, Guus, from a business point of view, is this the top priority, pure rational from the business point of view? No, of course not. I've got probably 100 emails. And a few from yesterday, and I need to call this, but I enjoy being here. And my advice would be, when it comes down to networking, start defining your dream, realize the only valuable thing in life is time, and time ticks away, and no matter what you do, you can't earn back lost time. Create that sense of direction, ask yourself what are the boundary conditions I need to get in place to realize my dream, and then execute on it every single day. And every tiny little baby step you make, which might not be significant in that moment, if you add it all up and you have the guts to stick to your dream, you will make it. You can do anything in life you want.
Do you recognize this, Simone?
No, not everything, actually.
About being a good dad, yeah.
Well, the part that you divide your day and make every hour as usual as possible, I don't recognize that, no. It's just not the way that I work.
How do you work?
Yeah, I do have this dream which is far away, and I think what I do recognize is that you have to express yourself in what you do, and sometimes it's just the right moment that you express yourself, and that could be serendipity. So, for example, a couple of years ago, after I had a technology company and we sold the company to TripAdvisor, it was Eens, and at that time we were working a lot with the Financiële Dagblad. So I came from the corporate world, so I had this corporate career, and then I became an entrepreneur, and that company got sold. But I liked the corporate world as well. And when I worked with the Financiële Dagblad, I said, oh, I would love to be again in that type of environment. And I was asked for it was by a headhunter, and they had this lunch with women of a certain career, a little bit like that. And I was thinking, so inconvenient to get there. But there was something in my head that said, okay, let's just explore it. I had never been to this lunch. It was in Amsterdam, and I said, okay, let's go. And at that time, I was sitting next to someone, and we were just, you know, thinking a bit out loud. So where are we in our life? What do we want to do? And I said to that person, actually, I really would love to sit in a non-executive role in one of the big publishers, because I'm working with the Financiële Dagblad, and I would love actually to be a non-executive Financiële Dagblad or whatever. But that really would suit my career at this moment, because I have this corporate experience, and now I have the digital experience, and all these publishers, they're really busy with this digital transformation. So I think I could really play a good role there. And it was just that person who said to me, really? I never thought about that for you, but I actually am looking for a role in Telegraaf, so a Telegraaf Media Group. And so I ended up as one of the first, one of the first women in that non-executive role in the Telegraaf Media role. And we sold the company eventually to Mediahuis. It was a huge adventure. But for me, it was, I expressed myself what I wanted. It was a surprise for someone else, because it was a dream, and I wasn't really ready for it in a way, because I was ready for it for my expertise, but I was lacking some of the things, because Telegraaf at the time was a listed company, and normally they would only look to people who already had these non-executive roles at listed companies. So that was one thing. And it was also the serendipity that you go to an event where you really don't know beforehand, really, does it bring me anything, but okay, let's just do it. And so this expression of what you want, and then be at the right place sometimes, yeah, that sometimes just happens.
Yeah.
But further, there are a lot of things which I don't plan, and sometimes you do things where I'm pioneering new things, so I'm a bit too early in things. So I was quite early in starting a digital company in the restaurant space at the time, and I was early in having these non-executive roles in listed companies. But actually now with my Borski fund, where we raised a venture fund to invest in diversity and technology companies, I'm actually quite late to the space, because most of the people who start in venture space are in their 30s or something like that. And I'm quite late, but I really wanted to do this. I really wanted to have, you know, to sort of have this in my third, what is it, period of your career? I don't know, Angela, how you had a name for it, your sort of...
Mid-career.
Different stages in life.
Yeah. Yeah, ideas, exactly. Careers. And I'm in my, almost in my third career, and I really still wanted to do this. So it is possible to change in a lot of careers, but if I look back now, I already work 31 years, you know? I'm like, really, am I already working 31 years? But I did change my career every 7 years or something like that. So it is possible that where you are now in your career, you're not there in 10 years or in 20 years. But in those 10 and 20 years, you use your network, or you explore your network in order to make that happen as well. So people who were instrumental in my first years of my career are instrumental also in what I'm doing now. So it's a long-term thing, this network.
Long-term relationships. Do you have that too, Beata? That it goes beyond the years that you...
Yes.
Yeah? Could you give an example of that?
Yes, multiple as well. I can't occupy that much time. A reflection that I had, because it's about like speaking up what you want. I would like to maybe comment on this first, because you know sometimes, and that's what I was saying, it's really important about who knows what you want, and you know, when I was actually engaged very much in that really the movement for women empowerment internally at Philips, somehow my colleague, a male colleague, was maintaining a collaboration with SAP. And actually, he got an email saying, "Oh, we are looking for panelists for women in procurement. Do you know someone?" Well, he knew me, and he knew I was in procurement that time. So he actually said, "Well, I think that might be something for you." But I was like, "Wow, that actually sounds nice. Let me explore what's there." Well, what I didn't realize is there were 5 invited panelists in that panel. It was online. And 4 of us were female CPOs, and I was the only one that wasn't. So I was like, wow, that's really a step up for me, because it's really a completely different network. And it was really something that I wanted to do anyway. So, you know, you just jump on those opportunities. And I think once you are there, it's important just to feel that you belong. You know, it's like, forget about, you already have that ticket, you are already, you have the seat, you have your chair at the table, be there, be present, and just make use of this. Like, really don't, like, forget about being intimidated. Just really do your best, because you contribute. And, you know, you prove your value, you know what you bring to the table, and don't be shy about yourself. So that's what I wanted to bring, because it happened on multiple occasions, that something happened for me, because I would just spoke up, oh, would be nice to do that, or to have a podcast, or, you know, to be at certain events, and it happened, so.
And sometimes you might need some help, and yes. Simone, I know you're a big advocate for a sponsor.
Yeah.
Could you tell us a little bit more about that? How do you find one, and what is it?
Yeah, so there's a difference between whether you're inspired by role models, whether you get support from a mentor, or whether it's a sponsor. And I think when I look back to in my career, I always had sponsors who just would support me in something that I really wanted. So for example, in the Borski fund, when we had a small fund of $1 million, of an angel fund, we invested in 30 technology companies, and then a couple of years ago we said, okay, we proved our point with this pilot fund, now we want to go for a much larger fund. And I went to someone out of my network who is running a much larger fund, and I explained what I wanted, and I said, what do you think? Do you think it's feasible? And especially with new things, what you want, there are always a lot of people who will tell you, that's not going to work. No, it's really not going to work. You're not ready. You should have this. And then for me, it works then to have someone who says, ah, that's a great idea. If you make it happen, I'll be one of your first investors. And that really encouraged me. A couple of people who were behind a plan what you were having. And I had that with Borski Fund, and it helped us to help me to find a partner and to get through that fund raising cycle, which, as you know, you get a lot of no's, so you have to cheer up yourself, and sometimes you're just not able to cheer yourself up, and then you need sponsors around you who say, yes, you are on the right path. I mean, I need it. There are people who do not need that at all, but and so that is a sponsor for me who just makes things happen, and you just need a little bit more. And that could be people out of your network who support the idea. They want to open up your network for you, and you just get that extra. And if I look back to my careers, and especially with career changes, if I had a sponsor, I would jump much faster and harder. And if I didn't have a sponsor, then it is harder, because there are always people around you who do then have that sponsor who have who come into a better position. So it could be in a promotion that you are making, or in that in a grant that you need to have, or whatever. But for me, a sponsor around you, and this is something that you have to ask to people, and you have to also. Yeah, it could be that people say, no, I don't think you're ready for it. I would like to be your sponsor, but I think this and this and this should first be done before I could be your sponsor. But for me, it works very well.
Guus, how do you find a sponsor? How do you find someone who vouch for you?
I don't have a single answer. It depends on the situation. It depends on the size of what you want to achieve. But I would like to echo what Simone is saying here. I mean, people now say that, you know, the speed with which we have raised that 100 million fund is that's never seen before in the Netherlands, especially with pension funds, considering we are a first-time team. And that made me think, indeed, in hindsight, what happened is, if ASML, Peter Wenning himself, didn't ask me to make a master plan how our ambition could be bigger, better, more impactful, and then when we came back and we presented the plan and having a fund was one of the critical elements, he said, yeah, I'm gonna help you. He was sponsoring us. He said, you can count on ASML at least gonna contribute 100 million because this is of crucial importance for the region, what we are doing here. We have to create the BSML, the CSML, the DSML. ASML is gonna help you and I'm gonna personally help you. And that makes all the difference because shortly thereafter, talking about the network, we were having a chat with some of the board members of the pension fund. Now, that network was established by one of the team members who worked with that person in another setting 20 years ago. But he maintained the relationship so he could pick up the phone and we were in fact invited by that board member at home. And then this person said, well, you know, it's great, and we just received a petition from Young ASML. They have been analyzing what we are doing with their pension funds, and they wrote a petition. He said, yeah, you pension fund, you invest way too much abroad, not in the Netherlands, notably also in non-sustainable stuff as oil and gas, and we demand you to do more in the Netherlands, to do more in innovation, and more in sustainability.
You know, I wrote that article, huh?
Power of the network. Power of the network.
I actually wrote that article. Yeah.
So
I mean, I wrote an article about there's this thing that pension funds have not invested enough in the venture industry, and.
Yeah, you cannot plan for this. Yeah. So this is indeed sometimes you just need a bit
diversity
of simple
is a little bit too far from them for the pension field still, but I think this hopefully opens up that the next is.
Yeah, and that is then also the network because a few of us are fighting for that same purpose, namely we need to see more impact-making tech companies conquering the world who grow their business in the Netherlands to secure that we have high-end jobs now and in the future. High-end in the sense that it's value-add. And then, you know, we can bring economic prosperity for the next generations. And the more we fight for that purpose together, we make the impact eventually. So networking is also making sure there is a purpose which unites people behind a certain journey, and it can be tough, but then together you can make it happen. And again, it starts step by step, but you need to have that first sponsor to make that dream work.
If someone calls you and asks, do you want to be my sponsor, what do you say?
I say, I'm very busy, so what's your dream? No, I always, and you know it, I can back it up with plenty of examples. I want to help. I truly believe that if you are, if let me turn it around. If you are not making it your mission to help others, in my view, you're wasting your time. The question is, how can you make the biggest impact? And for me, I'm always willing to see how I can help. Sometimes it's a personal effort. If you ask me in the next session to do another expert session on entrepreneurship or whatever, I will do it. I will then follow it up and ask the people who are interested to follow it up. Because I then, at that moment in time, also make my judgment. If I do this, what kind of impact can I achieve by helping this relative to other initiatives I could support? So it really depends on the impact. And to be honest, also, I think I can be very kind, and I know for sure I can be hard as a nail. So if this is something I also want to say, networking, be aware of toxic people. There are a lot of people who are not genuinely pursuing the right purpose, and they can talk very nicely about it. Be aware about that. Engage with people who also give you a good feeling in your network. You know how I make, in the end of the day, my decisions? I rationalize things, I strategize things, I validate things, I ask others on their opinion, and in the end of the day, I listen to my belly feeling. And if it feels right, I'm going to do it. And if all the rationalization is positive and my belly feeling says you shouldn't do it, I'm not going to do it. And I ask you the... And think about it yourself. How many times did you not listen in the end of the day to your belly feeling? You did it, and in hindsight, I should have listened to my belly feeling. So also be aware in the network about you. How can you make the impact? What do you give back to others? Does it feel good? Do you have fun?
With one life, so.
Right? Some people, for me, are just not fun, and then I'm brutally honest. So no, I had a deal. We could make a deal with a certain bank in Amsterdam, and blah blah blah, and it was too good to be true business wise. And I told that board member, said, we're not going to do it. He said, how is that possible? Here's a contract. I said, yeah, but you and me? It's not working for me. I'm sorry. And that's also important in your network, to be yourself, to be honest, even if the message is not nice. Kind is nice. Being kind is nice. You can be very clear in a kind way. Even though the message might not, from a content point of view, be a nice one to receive, but clear as kind.
So to start with, we want to do a small experiment with the audience. And Simone, you would like to introduce this, right?
Yeah, because we were talking about strange things, what can happen in network situations. And I actually had three times that... For a couple of years, I went to Dell conferences, and I thought there was someone here from Dell as well, or you were in a BNR talk, or this morning on the radio as well, I heard. And in the US, people need to connect really quickly, and they are spread out all over the US. And what they did a lot, and that was very, in my view, very un-European, was to start with a very personal story, and they said, okay, why don't you tell? Let's tell each other a story that you haven't told anyone else before. And I was there in a group with this girl from Sweden, and we were like, really? Something that we're really not going to do. And all the people from the US were like, yes, we do this all the time. Yeah, so people were really open. And the funny thing in that conference, when we did this, it was the evening before the conference, is because we all heard these sort of very private stories where you almost felt a little bit embarrassed that you knew this about a person, that the next day in that conference, when you would walk around, you would say, you had really a little connection with that person, and it really sped up your connection. And the other example which I had I'll tell three examples already?
Maybe two. Yeah.
Two.
One more. Yeah.
Yeah.
Now you were going to tell that story. You didn't tell anybody.
Huh?
And shared it with everybody. That was the experiment.
No, the other one was...
You changed the script.
No, the other one was... I was doing a round table with the General Entrepreneurship Summit a couple of years ago when Ivanka Trump came along in The Hague. And it was all, you know, these round tables, and I was supposed to be the sort of role model chairing the table with all these US and Dutch entrepreneurs from the top 100. And we had this thing like, okay, you have to tell something about your something business-like and then something private-like, in order, because I was sort of inspired, let's do it like this way. And And I thought, and so that's what I did. And so everybody told that story, and it's something private. It didn't have to be a story that you had never told anyone before. And I did the same. So I said, okay. So I, you know, I was a lawyer, and then I did the whole my whole resume. And then I said, okay, now I have to say something private. And I said, yeah. And actually, this is the week where my last child is leaving the house, and I was. And I started to cry. It just couldn't stop. And I really thought, really? I even didn't know that I had an empty nest syndrome. And I just, and I was, you know, I was sitting there and sort of in my hair done. And I was supposed to be the role model on this thing. And it was so private that I just couldn't, you know, and many of us are just not taught to show your private feelings or in business situations. So, and but it really bonded. That's, and I was so surprised by it. So even after the conference, people came to me and said, oh, Simone, and this and that. And I, the power of, you know, of showing your vulnerability, you know, is something that I was so astonished by, and we are just not used to that. So that's, and the third, and I do have to thank the third, because that was the Borski Fund. So we were sitting with all these investors or our potential investors, and I wanted to go quick and said, okay, are you interested to come along and invest in this fund? We're doing diversity, that's that. I really wanted to. And then there was someone who would lead this this sort of round table for us, for my business partner and I. And she started with sort of exercises like, okay, just stand up. And we, with the two of us, we were looking at each other, really? I thought we were going to talk about our investment memorandum and who wants to commit, and are they committing 1 million or 10 million? And she started with, okay, let's stand up and exercise, and then tell us your dreams, and go and stand. And the funny thing was, we went to all this, and it took us really, and then I all of a sudden, and had much more a connection with all these people who were from the banks and from the pension funds, and all of a sudden these sort of functions became persons, because it wasn't all about what they did in their business life, it was who they were and what their dreams were and why were they interested in diversity and what was their dream to increase diversity in the business space, but also to increase diversity in the world space and whatever. And it did work. And for us, it really meant the start of our anchor investors, because many of that circle became our anchor investors in our Borski Fund. And I'm up till now, I'm sure that it would never have happened if we would have come immediately to business. Mm-hmm. Which you sometimes want to do if you are, you know, you're short in time and you think, okay, let's just pitch my business immediately, you know, and it doesn't really work. So these were the sort of personal thing. And so we wanted to do an experience.
Yeah.
And this is really an experiment, because we are with a big group. Eh?
We're with a really big group. So you don't have to participate, but it will be great if you would like to. So you do not have to share anything with us or with a microphone. But just find someone in the audience, maybe in your back or next to you. And you don't have to maybe share something you never told before. Maybe something really personal.
Yeah, I thought about it. So why don't you, it's good to say, what wouldn't you know about me? What is there something that most people don't know about me? It could be a really small thing, or what you wouldn't know about me, or what is very different than you would see at first sight. It could be that you are, you know, painting, or that you do belly dancing, or whatever you do, you know?
I mean, and the next time you see that person, you're like...
That you see the person as a person, and not in its function, or you are not the entrepreneur, or the corporate, or the doctor, but who are you if you're not your function?
So maybe the technical crew in the back can put some music on, very loud, very loud. And you can just look to someone, you can do it with the three of you, and we'll just give you a few minutes and you don't have to tell how it went.
Yeah.
That's okay, so maybe some music.
Yeah. Who are you if you're not your function?
Leuk.
Ja, wie ben jij als je niet fondsmanager bent? Wie ben je dan?
Dan ben ik iemand die het liefst op zichzelf is, heel rustig.
Huh?
Dan ben ik het liefst op mezelf.
Thank you so much. Thank you. All right. So I hear there will be a lot of networking afterwards. Right? Yeah. So this is just a start. And maybe in a few years from now you remember someone, you were that belly dancer. I mean, that's how it works. No, but give a very big applause to our three panelists, Simone, Guus, and Beata. Yeah, Ingelou, this was it. The third edition of the Fe+male.
The DJ is already texting me that his DJ booth is ready outside for you.
So we would like to thank you for being here today. We had a wonderful time with real people again. So we hope to see you at new Fe+male Tech Heroes events. Enjoy the networking and drinks, the DJ as well. And
we keep in touch.
Next time, we'll see each other again.